still beautiful out. Birthdays and anniversaries this week. We have Katie Moffitt has a birthday, so happy birthday, Katie. She's not here, but happy birthday. And anniversaries, we have Dale and Brenda Wagner, Pastor Money and Anita. How many years? Your people. 48. Ah. Jim and Alice Booth and Vic and Marilyn McCloskey. Happy anniversary, everyone. A couple of announcements I'd like to go through really fast would be for this month, June 10th. That's just around the corner. We have our ice cream social, silent auction, and trivia bowl. The information is in your bulletin, so please take a look at that and make sure you mark your calendar if you haven't done so already. On the 17th, we have the Peoria Chiefs game, and I was just told that there are only 16 tickets left out of 50 tickets available. So if you have not signed up for that yet, make sure you get that done ASAP, and that is down by the office window. Then in July, we have VBS. Yes. Okay, that was kind of weak. That was good, but that was really good. we have the Hero Central PBS coming in July. And,
yay!
Thank you. And so there is a sign-up sheet for volunteers downstairs by the office window if you're interested in volunteering. And you can choose which where you'd like to volunteer at. There are also registration sheets for our kiddos down there, or you can go online and register, and that website is in your bulletin. Volunteers can also register there as well. So get that done as soon as possible. I'll be coming out the next couple of weeks with a wish board for items that we could use during Vacation Bible School, and volunteer registration will wrap up by the end of this month so that we have time to get the supplies we need and make sure we have our meeting and all that fun stuff. And then July 30th, we have our church picnic, and that is also our Vacation Bible School celebration. So we're going to put those two together, and it's just going to be a super fun day. So make sure that you mark your calendars for that as well. This week, there is no kids club or youth group. There is Bible study, though, I believe. Right? Yes? Okay. There's Thursday Bible study Wednesday night, but no kids group or youth group. It's not a youth group. Okay, and with that?
Men's group.
Oh, there's men's group. Men's group Tuesday night at 6:30. Okay, men's group is Tuesday night at 6:30. And with that, how about we get our praise on? With me this week, Romans 8:28. We know that in all things God works for the good of those who love Him. And you know, there's times in our life that we get so stuck in what's going on around us, and we forget that God is with us and God is there helping us through everything that we have going on if we just put our faith and our trust in Him. So this is our time right now to give back to Him, to show Him how much we love Him, and to just to sing our praises, to dance, to meditate on the words of the song, whatever suits you. Let's just use this time to praise Him and thank Him.
Come on.
come up.
Yeah. Let me see that. I did rich and like I did mine. I want to make sure that it's me, my turn. This is a great day. No, it is. It really is. Amen. And I know that you were happy for Anita. 48 years coming up at 8. And I know that she will be great. I don't know. Sister Teresa. And some of you other sisters out here as well. Because I know I'm not the only man who's been a headache. And every woman here should have said, amen. Amen. But I know you're trying to make him look good today. I understand. I understand. The goodness of God. He is so good.
Amen.
He is so good. Amen. Amen. Come over and sing that song, Good, Good Father. It's who he is. That's who he is.
Right.
He is good. He is good. And when we make it personal, Abba, Abba Father, that's who he is. Daddy, Daddy. We need to know the Lord in such a way. Come on, people. We ought to know the Lord in such a way that we ought to be able, again, to find comfort in him, to find strength in him, to know that he is God in every circumstance.
Yes.
This is what it might look like. Angela, when she was in school, made an egg, a ceramic, clay thing, whatever they do, and it's all painted up. She did all of those things, and it fell and it broke. And then when her grandmother said, oh, honey, it's your egg broke, she said, it's all right. My daddy will fix it.
Amen.
And we took those pieces, and we got the glue, and we put all of those little slivers and everything back in place, and she said, see, I told you, my daddy would fix it. That's me. That's me. It doesn't matter how broke we are. He is able to fix it. And we need to know this morning in that God is a fixer for our lives. Whatever you need, he's able to fix it. We need to know that this morning. I thank God for each and every one of you. I was talking to Alvin, our beloved catfish. I was looking in the paper. Auxiliary Volunteer of the Year again. Amen. In this year, you will be stepping down. He said, I can't do it anymore. Amen. But God has blessed him.
Amen.
We appreciate you. Didn't know your name, but saw you in all the football games and all of those things many, many years ago. And you've been faithful, holding your post till this day. We thank God for men like you. Amen.
Amen.
Just like many, his dear friend, after the passing of his beloved wife, he met someone, Nellie, a good woman. We knew she was good. Yeah, she was a catfish. Had to be a good woman. She went home to be with the Lord. Her battle with cancer is over. And you know, and he said, it hurts. It hurts. And again, he said, it hurts. And I don't know what you're going through this morning, but we have a God who can fix it.
Amen.
Fix it. So no matter what you're going through this morning, I'm asking that you just say, Lord, I'm broke, and I need fixing. My life is broke. My family is broke. We need fixing. Whatever your circumstance, situation that you're going through this morning, we serve a God who can fix it.
Amen.
He can fix it. that matter, the pain and going through. I was talking to the young lady who passing up her mom. She looked at me, tears coming down her eyes. She says, "It hurts. He'll be her comfort. He'll be her strength. He'll fix it." That's who we serve. We matter to God this morning. Amen. You need to know that. We matter. We matter. Your afflictions. He says, "I'm familiar. I know what you're going through." And He is our comfort. Father, we come this morning, Lord, we rejoice in the mentioning of your name. We thank you, Lord, that you're able, Lord, to do exceedingly above all that we have asked and hoped, Lord. We come this morning, Lord, and we just say thank you. Thank you for waking us up, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for being with us, guiding us, and directing us. And Lord, and when we fall down, Lord, I thank you, Lord, that you have never let hold of us, but you'll continue to hold us, Lord, and bring us back up, Lord, that we might know how to stand on the foundation that is laid in you. Oh, Lord, you are good. And we want to praise you this morning, Lord, with our whole heart, our whole being, Lord. We want to exalt you, Lord, and lift you up, dear Heavenly Father, and thank you, Lord, for your great love that you continue to smile upon us with. Lord, I pray this morning. I pray this morning, Lord, for the sick and the afflicted, Lord, many, Lord, that are in the hospital, Lord, even now. And we lift them up to you, Lord. Some things, Lord, the doctor said, this is what it is, but others, Lord, they just looked at you and said, I don't know. But, Lord, you know. You know what we're standing in need of, Lord, today, Lord. And we come before your throne, and we say, Lord, have mercy upon us. Touch us, Lord, in a mighty way, Lord. Do what only you can do, Lord, is where we're at this morning. We come this morning. And we thank you, Lord, for every breath we take in the day that you give us, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for that. We thank you for the promise of your great salvation, Lord, and eternity, Lord, that is waiting for us, Lord. We come this morning, and we just ask, Lord, that you would do the miraculous, Lord. There's some, Lord, many that are needing a miracle. Lord, you do miracles. Lord, we come this morning, and we declare, hallelujah, healing. Healing in the precious name of Jesus. Lord, I pray this morning, Lord, that we would just know, Lord, that not only will you heal here, but Lord, we know we'll be healed when we come into your presence. But Lord, we ask that you would extend days, years, with quality life, Lord. We pray this morning, Lord, and let the young Cody too. Lord, he needs a miracle. Let us see, Lord, your glory, Lord, come down. Lord, I pray this morning, Lord, for our sons and daughters in the military. We pray, Lord, that they would come home, Lord, whole and safe, Lord, to their families. We pray this morning, Lord, for guidance and direction for our community and our county, for this state, for this nation, Lord. We ask, Lord, that men and women who are sitting in authority, Lord, they would humble themselves before Almighty God. That we would know, Lord, that they are being led by you, Lord. But I pray today, Lord, that the reality would come to all. That no man, no woman has achieved anything, Lord, that it must have been granted by you. Let us see this morning, Lord, just where we're at, where we lie. If it had not been for you on our side, Lord, where would we be? Oh, Lord, I pray this morning, Lord, that we would just say, have your way. Guide us and direct us, Lord, in truth. And so we come before you, Lord. All-knowing, almighty God. We come to you, Lord, because you are the provider, Lord, and the deliverer. You are the strong tower, Lord, that we find safety in, Lord. You are the rock on which we stand. We come before you, Lord, because it was your precious blood that was shed. It was you that took our stripes upon you, Lord. We come before you, Lamb of God. And we humble ourselves and say, have your way. We ask your blessing, Lord. Lord, upon this community, Lord, we pray this morning, Lord, for opportunities to share this hope, Lord, with others, that they might come to know you, Lord, and to know of your goodness and your forgiving grace and mercy that you give. And so, Jesus, we thank you. We thank you, Lord. Be with us, guide us, and direct us in all truth, Lord. And may we stand firm in the faith. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Let's give the Lord praise.
Thank you.
And I said like that because we have to give by the heart, from the heart. It has to come from the heart. You're not paying your dues and you ain't paying your silco bill. I know if you're paying your silco bill, you'd be frowning right now, especially next month after you have to use that air. But we ought to be cheerful givers because of the goodness of what God has done in our heart and in our lives. I pray this morning that when the plate comes, that you believe that God will take your offering, your tithe, your giving, and he will use it for the furtherance of the kingdom of God. That you would give this morning knowing that someone in need would be helped. That you would give this morning knowing that some life might be touched, Lord, because of an opportunity of someone to be able to go here and go there, and that lives may be touched and changed. Let us believe that not only will they be changed in Canton and Fulton County and State of Illinois and in this nation, but also touched around the world. That's what your giving does. It touches here and far, and we need to know that this morning, that God desires to do a mighty thing, and he's able to do it because of your generosity. And so as you give this morning, give with an expectation of what God will do with your gift. Ushers, would you now come and wait upon us?
Right now, oh. Yeah, you're right. does.
Okay, well today we have a lot of sunshine. This morning, before Miss Christy picked me up for church, I was out walking around my yard looking at all my beautiful flowers. And I love green grass, love beautiful flowers. God's given us a lot of beautiful things in this world, hasn't he?
Yes.
He's given us a lot of weird things, too. Can you think of one? Well, what are the weird things? Maybe you have one? Weird. One of the weird things, I call it weird, but they're really pretty amazing, that we're going to talk about today is an aardvark. That's even kind of weird to say, isn't it?
It is.
Hold your mouth just right. It comes out like aardvark. Okay, do you know what one looks like? An aardvark? Okay, well, here's a picture of one. Isaiah, do you know what an aardvark looks like? An aardvark. Okay. An aardvark has some really special features. God made it with this long, long nose. Does anyone know what an aardvark eats? Ants, that's right. And did you know, did Frank know that too?
That's right!
Now, when an aardvark looks for ants, he's got this long, long nose and he sticks it in the ground and looking for ants. And God has given him this amazing capability of being able to close his nostrils while he's digging and eating ants so that they don't crawl up his nose. That is weird. But you know what? God gave the aardvark that ability. If he's given each one of you your own special abilities and gifts, can you tell me one thing that you're really, really good at? Cadence. Reading. What about your tongue abilities?
Yeah.
She's good. National with those. Kidding. Softball. Football. Archery. You have a special gift? Isaiah. Caleb. Being able to swim. You get lots of practice now, don't you?
Yes, he's got a
Caleb. Okay. Caleb, what do you like to do? Okay, I'm not sure what it is, but that's good. How about you, Caleb? You have anything? Well, there's all these people in the grace team behind us. They're great at singing and playing instruments and all kinds of things like that. What about Pastor? I was going to say give a gap, but that's much nicer. Okay, well, as you grow older, too, you might find another special gift that God's given you. So I just encourage you to find what that gift is. It might be kindness, and you can make these new friends at school and use those. Or it might be you have really good math, and then you can help. So it could be any different kind of thing. Just like the aardvark. Maybe you like the dance. You never know. Okay. All right, let's pray, and then we're going to go to Children's Church. Okay, look at this. Lord God, we thank you for this day, and I thank you for each of the children here. And Lord, I just ask them that you help them find their special talents and gifts that you've given them, and that they use them more to glorify you. We love you and praise you. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
may be seated. Those of you that will serve this morning, would you come? It's a little over a minute.
Let us prepare our hearts as we come to celebrate the Lord's Supper. These sacraments symbolize that God's promise that the finished work of Christ will indeed be fulfilled. In communion, we focus on Jesus Christ. Let us not allow the cares of the world to distract us as we remember the birth and death of our Messiah. In the reign of Jesus, our everlasting King, for as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. 1 Corinthians, Paul tells us, the teaching I gave you is the same teaching I received from the Lord. On the night when the Lord Jesus was handed over to be killed, he took bread and gave thanks for it. Again on that night, God's word tells us that Jesus took a cup and prayed. And so we now give thanks for the cup of blessing which symbolizes the blood of Christ. Let us pray. Scripture tells us in Luke 22, when the hour came, Jesus and his apostles reclined at the table, and he said to them, I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I will not eat it again until it finds fulfillment in the kingdom of God. And he took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to them, saying, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Let us eat. After taking the cup and giving thanks, Jesus said, take this and divide it among you, for I tell you, I will not drink again from the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes. In the same manner, Jesus said, taking the cup, this cup is a new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you. When you drink this, do it in remembrance of me. Let us drink. Give thanks for the cup of blessing, which represents the blood of Christ. And the bread that we break represents the body of Christ. Every time you eat this bread and drink this cup, you are telling others about the Lord's death and resurrection until he comes. Amen.
Amen.
This morning, Ray came, and Ray will be doing our services for the next two Sundays while I'm gone. Praise the Lord. Amen. Accepted the call on his life to serve the Lord, and he'll be starting school and coming up soon, and we thank God for him. And so I ask that you take your right hand and point it towards Ray as we pray for him, as God will use him over the next several weeks and the rest of his life. Father, we come today, Lord, we thank you, Lord, for Ray. We thank you, Lord, for his faithfulness to you. And Lord, and I thank you, Lord, that you have touched him in such a way. And Lord, and you have called him, as you called us all, Lord, but then you said, come unto me and go forward in my name, Lord, and he has said yes to you. We ask, Lord, that over these next years of studying, Lord, and continuing education, Lord, to take this call, Lord, that you would bless him, watch over him, be his strength, write your word upon his heart, use him in such a mighty way, Lord, and his family. Lord, we thank you, Lord, that he knows that he can't run this by himself, and so we ask your blessing upon his wife as well. We ask, Lord, that you be with Ray and Gretchen and their family. We ask these blessings now in Jesus' name. Let every heart say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Using him now, and will use him in the future. His desire one day is to pastor a church, and we thank God for his acceptance to that call. This morning, as we look at 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 through 8, I'd ask that you stand for the reading of the word, those of you that can. I'd ask that we read the word together. Ready? Read. Jesus has the power of God, by which he has given us everything we need to live and serve God. We have these things because we know him, because he has called us by his glory and goodness. Through these, he has gave us very great and precious promises. With these gifts, you can share in God's nature, and the world will not ruin you with his evil desires. Because you have these blessings, do your best and add these things to your lives. To your faith, add goodness, and to your goodness, add knowledge. And to your knowledge, add self-control. And to your self-control, add patience. And to your patience, add service for God. And to your service for God, add kindness, and for your brothers and sisters in Christ. And to this kindness, add love. If all these things are in you and you are growing, they will help you to be useful and productive in your knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. Father, we thank you, Lord, that you are calling us, Lord, in this hour, Lord, to take the charge, to go forth, Lord, into the world, Lord, knowing you and proclaiming the good news of your love. Lord, I pray this morning and thank you, Lord, that you would use us for the furtherance of your kingdom. May we be a bright, shining light, Lord, in our homes, on our jobs, in our activities, Lord, as our coming and going back and forth. We pray, Lord, this morning that you would open our understanding to the truth of Scripture. Write your word upon our heart and bring it to remembrance. And then, Lord, I pray that we would have ears to hear, a heart to receive, Lord, and also the courage to walk out your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And amen. You may be seated. This morning, we want to look at the Word of God. And the message this morning is the redeemed have God-giving blessings. We've been talking about the redeemed now for the past several weeks. And over that time, we've been understanding that God has called us to live a life for him. That the redeemed are those who are born again, who have received Christ as their personal Savior. The redeemed understand that God has paid the debt that only he could pay through Jesus Christ shedding of his blood, the giving of his life. And it was demonstrated his love and his faithfulness as Father rose him from the grave. Hallelujah. The Spirit of God touched him, rose him from the grave, and he walks again in the glory of the calling that is his. He is the giver of life. Faith is in Christ and Christ alone. And the struggle that we find ourselves in, as we looked in 1 Peter, was to encourage the church to understand who we are. I believe that the trouble that we have today in the church is that we don't understand who we are in Christ Jesus. I know that we can say, well, you know, I'm born again, I believe. I accepted the Lord as my Savior and I allowed him to come into my life. But we, many of us, have not moved past that station. Now, again, I'm not talking about you. I'm talking about the person that normally would be sitting next to you. That one in the pew in front of you that is empty and the one sitting behind you. They really needed to hear this message, but you're going to have to listen to it this morning. He's called us to be a light in this life in which we're living. The problem with us many times is that we were born again. We've been washed in the blood. We believe that Christ did all of those things. We believe John 3:16, God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. We believe that. We believe that our sins have been forgiven. But what has, where struggle has come is that we have not understood the call of the redeemed. When we are redeemed, we've been called for the service of God. We've been called to live for him. The promise of salvation is that one day, Jesus said, I will return and you will be with me forever. This morning, as we took of the cup and we took of the bread, it reminds us of what Christ's suffering and his blood that was shed For it says, for the forgiveness of sin only comes through the shedding of blood. And Christ shed his blood that we might be saved. The Bible says that Jesus is the Lamb of God who took away the sins of the earth. And so when we find that we understand that part of it, we say, all right, I got it. But that's just the beginning. Because the walk with Christ can only come to those who have life in Christ Jesus. Those who have been born again are the only one that God is requiring them to live a holy and righteous life. He has never asked us when we were in our sin to live holy and be righteous, because that would be an impossible task. But only because of who Christ is and the Holy Spirit that now lives in us allows us to be able to live a life that would truly bring God glory and bring Him honor. So he said, Pastor, I get that. I get that. I understand that with my whole heart. I understand that Jesus did all of those things. But then why did he give us this gift and then say to us, go into all the world and preach the gospel? Why did he tell us to go and make disciples? Why did he tell us then to go to the outer parts of the world? He wanted us to begin to share what we have experienced in Christ Jesus. And that's where the church struggles at today. Paul, when we were studying out of 1 Peter, it was about telling and warning the church of persecution that would come. It was about telling the church that troubles were going to be along the way. Jesus in Scripture has reminded us, in his life, you should have trials and tribulations, but be of good cheer because I've overcome the world. So he has told us that in our life we'll have this and that, some ups and downs, some heartaches, some heartbreaks, some struggles that life will come. Not only that life will bring, but things will happen because why? I have made bad choices. Have you ever made a bad choice? Have you not done what God has called you to do? No, I just need you to look at me, don't look at your neighbor. Have you ever made that choice?
Yes.
Some of you did this. You didn't make a bad choice. We made bad choices. But God has called us to a call of holiness and righteousness. See, we struggle at those words, and I said that the last time we shared. We struggle at the thought of being holy. Be holy because I am holy. That's what the Scripture tells us. And that we are called the righteousness of God. But to do those things and to walk in those manner is that we have to know Him who is what? The righteous God and who is holy. We have to know Him in such a way. And so we have accepted Christ as our Savior. We are now in Him as He is in the Father and the Father is in Him. We are in Him and He is in us. But that is like a marriage relationship. That is like being married. So we've said all the vows. We've done all of those things. We've put on the rings. We lit the candles. We've done all of those things. We've kissed the bride. We've done all of that. But then that work begins. Marriage doesn't happen just because you did all of those things. Marriage is about the fact that now I have to begin to know who it is I've been married to. The person you fell in love with is not necessarily the person that you woke up one day and found yourself married to. Oh, don't give me that look, right, Pastor? I married the most perfect man and woman in the world, and there's never been a flaw in them at all since the day I met them. And if you met a liar, well, maybe not. But if she said that about you, Adam, then she would be lying. Now, we've grown in our relationships. We've grown because why? We're two people trying to now live as one. We're two people with different thoughts and ideas and perceptions on how life ought to be lived. And we have to begin to understand the person that we are connected to. Now, in our relationship with Christ, that we need to understand, Christ already knows us, for He saw us while we were being formed in our mother's womb. He saw us before the foundations of the world. He has known us from eternity's beginning, life's beginning. So it isn't about Him knowing us, it's about us now knowing who it is we are connected to, that we are in oneness with. What it is to have Christ as our Savior and Lord, what is that in the relationship that He has with and desires us to have with Him? And that's what the message is about the other day. It is about the fact that the price has been paid, but now the Lord is saying, do you know who it is you're connected to? And when you're connected to me, these are the things that ought to be coming out of you, because these are the precious blessings that I bring to you. See, we all bring something to the table. But when the Lord brings it to the table is full. And he is saying, I brought these gifts for you. But then they're gifts that are to be applied. So as we look at the text this morning, it began in verse 1. Let's look at that in 2 Peter 1. It says that it's from Simon Peter, so he declares who it is that is, and he's a servant and apostle of Jesus Christ. To you who have received a faith as valuable as ours, because our God and our Savior, Jesus Christ, does what is right or have obtained a faith of equal standing with ours by the righteousness of God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Peter is first of all letting us know that he is an apostle, that he has walked with Christ. He saw him. He was there with the miracles. He was one of the fishermen that became one of the first disciples of Christ. And Peter is telling us is that we walked with him for those 3.5 years in the journey and saw the miracles. We were there at the end. We saw them take him and they in captivity when they arrested him. We were there when they beat him, and we were there when they hung him on the cross. We were there when they took him and he was buried. And we were there when he rose from the grave. He says, that's who I am. That's my relationship I have with my Savior. That's what I have. But then he says, you have received those same things. You have obtained a faith of equal standing with ours by the righteousness of God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. He says, though you have not been where I've been in my relationship, because now you have received Christ as your personal Savior, you too have obtained everything I have obtained to know him as Savior. You see, sometimes we think that the apostles have something greater because they have walked with Jesus. But here scripture makes it clear, we have everything they have because we have put our faith in the same Jesus they have put their faith in. So then saying that, he goes on to tell us in text, God has given us blessings and that we are to confirm our calling and election. And in verse 3 it reads this, Jesus has the power of God by which he has given us everything we need to live and to serve God. We have these things because we know him. Jesus called us by his glory and goodness. Where we find in this verse that God has given us and he wants us to have this abundant grace and peace that only comes through him. The grace that he gives us, a supernatural empowerment to be able to live with God. The grace that we have received from him is something we could not earn on our own, but God gave it freely to us through his Son. It tells us that as believers in Christ, that we need to take what God has given us, and then we need to take these things because we know him. In the relationship that God is calling us to, he wants us to know him. He wants us to know his heart. What is a marriage if we don't understand and know the heart of the person that we're married to? God understands our heart. He understands my heart anyway. He understands that I love him, but he also understands that in me there's wickedness. He understands that. But he says, I'm still connected to you, and I desire you, and I want you. See, we're not that God called us because we're perfect. He called us because he loved us. He looked past our fault. He saw our need. But then he wants us to understand who he is. He is the righteousness of the Father. He is the fulfillment of every promise that the Word of God has ever spoken. From Genesis to Revelation, everything is about Jesus Christ and God's love towards us. And he wants us to understand how much he loves us. But he also wants us to understand what comes with loving him. And so in the text, he says to us, that we are, through the power of God, that has been given to us. And he has given us everything we need to live and to serve God. See, sometimes we stop there with live. He gives us everything that we need to live. But it also says to serve. And what is serving God? Oh, I thank God for everyone that came forward today, Lord, and we thank the Lowry family for coming, amen, amen, and serving us this morning. And Brother Ike, yeah. But that's not what he's talking about. He's not talking about cleaning the carpet, taking care of the lawn. Those things need to be done. He's not talking about going just to the hospital. Those things need to be done. But he says, I've called you to serve me. And what that means is that wherever you do and whatever you're doing it all to the fullest and the glory of God who is your Savior. That you're always ready to tell of the hope that lies within you. You're always ready to pray. You're always ready to encourage. You're always just and faithful to love and also ready to forgive. And that's who we are. And that's what he's talking about. He's saying that we are here to serve him and to know him and to do those things that Peter is speaking about tells us that we have to begin to change ourselves, change our lives to be that person that God would have us to be. And that changing is because to serve, have you ever tried to serve somebody you really just don't care for? Well, God says, the despicable, them that are sinners and they're not getting it right. And their life is a mess. And every time you go to them, they don't seem to get it right. And you tell them and you encourage them and they keep falling down and you begin to say, what to use? And then he says, but serve as I have served you. Because of what we're thinking sometimes of the call that he's placed upon us, God looked at us and let me rephrase that. He looked at me and he said, you're a mess. God did messes. And he's calling us to work in the mess ministry. To begin to share of the hope. See, when you're dealing with messes, you've got to have a power and an understanding of who Christ is in our life. To understand that he is able to take the worst of the worst and touch their lives in such a way that their lives will never be the same. When you're sharing Christ, there should not be an expectation of the glory of God to happen in an individual's life because of your testimony of Jesus Christ. That's what it's talking about here. It's talking about that we ought to know him and serve him with the understanding that God can do all things through Christ. And how do I know? Because I'm changing. I'm changing. I'm not the person that I used to be. And I'm changing. I'm not the person I was 5 years ago. I'm changing. I'm not the person I was 4 years ago. I'm changing. I'm not the person I was a year ago. I'm changing. I'm not the person I was 6 months ago. I'm changing. I'm not the person I was yesterday. I'm changing. I'm changing. See, it's out of that relationship that we have in him that we're able to share a hope to a dying world, but also to share a hope with brothers and sisters in Christ. And so he continues in the message to the church and he's sharing with them that you might call upon the glory of his glory and goodness and know him. But in verse 4 it says, through these he gave us a very great and precious promise. With these gifts you can share in God's nature and the world will not ruin you with its evil desires. It's telling the church today that we have to guard our hearts. And as I said in First Peter, that it was telling us about persecution to come. But this letter here was written 3 years later, and persecution has come now upon the church. They're killing the church. Those who take a stand for Christ are being, heads are being cut off. They're being nailed to the cross. They're dying during this time. And he's telling them, be careful, because why? There'll be others that say, well, you can serve God, but you don't have to do this. You can serve God, but you don't have to take a stand with this. You can be flexible. But Peter's warning the church that the Word of God is not flexible. It's not flexible. It doesn't bend. It's truth that has been given, and it's truth that does not change. We're dealing in a day right now that everyone is saying to us that we need to diversify, that we need to understand and understand the struggles that other people are going through. And I get it. They struggle with the identity of who they are and what they are. I get it. They struggle with the fact that They got struggles and difficulties in their life, and none of us can understand because why? You've never had difficulties and trials in your life. But the Word of God says that we have not because we've asked not. We've not looked to Him for our strength and for guidance and for direction. And so we allow people to say to us and say to the church, you cannot say this, that same-sex marriage is wrong, because you offend people. Lying, murder, stealing is wrong. I can say that from the pulpit. And if you're doing those things, you ought to be offended. Because why? The Word of God tells us how we ought to live. And He's challenging us in this day that the church needs to be able to stand on the promises of God. And if we don't stand on those promises, the church will no longer to exist. You cannot be the church with compromising. So He says you have to be careful of the evil that is being demonstrated and being asked of you today. Somehow it's strange that that was written 2,000 years ago, but it's applicable to the what we're living in today. Another congregation of believers are now struggling and about to split because why? They're debating over, did God make Adam and Steve, or did He make Adam and Eve? I read pretty good, though I'm not as smart as a fifth grader. But I know that it says Adam and Eve. And then He says to procreate, to have babies, be fruitful and multiply. And last time I understood the word and the understanding of the anatomy of man, two men can't do that. Two women can't do that. But that's just one thing. The other part of it is that how we're going to live in this life in which we're living. Marriage is just as important today as it was in the day of Jesus. If you love her, marry him. No. If you love her, marry her. If you love him, marry him. But we got to start shutting down. Because why? You're going to miss out on the blessings that God is calling us to. There's grace. There's mercy. He says that. And He says we come to a place of understanding. What do we really want? Do we want all that God has, or do we want part of what God has? The church has to begin to make a stand. And so when I meet with couples that are living together, have children together, I don't say to them, you got to get married right now and get it right with God. But I have to begin to tell them about the love of God and all that God promises and all that He has for their lives and that He is calling us to, that they can have the fullness of all that He has in store for them if they would just begin to just trust Him with their lives. And as we begin to tell them about the goodness of what God has called and done in us, they would begin to say, then that's what I need to do. Then I'm going to do those things because why? I want everything that Jesus has. I want everything that God has in store for me. So Peter is telling the church and saying to us today that we have to be children of God that's strong in the promises of God and know that the precious promises of God, these gifts that we can share in God's nature, and the world will not ruin us with his evil desires. We will take a stand on the truth of Scripture. And then he goes and tells us to be fruitful, to grow in growth in the faith. In verse 5 it says, because you have these blessings, do your best to add to these things to your life. To your faith, add goodness. That he's saying that you desire the things of God, that you desire the things that are right in him. And to your goodness, it says, add the knowledge. That you understand that I need to understand and have the knowledge of God and who he is according to Scripture. And the knowledge and understanding that when he tells me to do this, to be good and to be righteous, holy in him, that it is giving me an understanding of what the outcome and what the benefits are of doing what he has called us to do. So with that knowledge, I begin to understand that my life can begin to change because of what he has empowered me with his eternal goodness. See, we've all been empowered to live a life for God. We've been empowered to live a life that would bring him glory and bring him honor. and he is waiting for us to trust him. Stop waiting to have all your ducks in a row. Stop waiting to get economically right and finances all in place. You know, the last time a couple did that, they were sweethearts at 18, and they were going to get married, and one day they came, they finally had all their ducks in a row. They had their finances where they were, they had their education where they wanted to be, and they had lived their life, and they had built up all that they had and desired, and then they willed them down the aisle. Because they started out as teenagers, but they were in their 80s by the time they got it all figured out. You're not going to have it all figured out. But God is saying that we have to trust him, that we have to begin to walk with him and live with him in such a way that we might begin to have the knowledge of who he is and what he's desiring for us. And to your knowledge, he says, as in self-control. That he's saying to us that if we begin to understand what he offers and what we have in him, I can begin to then have self-control over desires of my flesh, my thoughts, the way I live and the way I act out life, the way that I do. See, we're not just saying that God has said, rule one, do this, rule two, do that, rule three, do that. Because why? We couldn't follow the rules. But he says, if you begin to build on the foundation that I have given you and called you to do, which was to do your best to add these things to your life so that your life will be blessed, that you have to operate in faith, that you have to operate in the goodness of God and who he is, and with the goodness of God, you have a knowledge of who you are, and the word of God that is good that came to us, that we would have the knowledge of what we have and who he is in our life, and what he has given us with this eternal life and with this new life, that we can add to that knowledge self-control. That I have control, that my anger doesn't have to control me. My actions don't have to control me. This is who I am. This is what I've done all my life. He says that if you do these things, the way you think, the way you do will change also with it. And you will have some control of your life. Have you ever lived a time in your life when your life was just out of control? I have. In fact, I thought my life was just out of control 2 weeks ago, just terribly out of control. Seemed like everything I touched, there was another problem behind that, another problem behind that, another. I tried to fix this thing, try to get this right, those things there. And finally, I just sat down and went, and then I heard this little voice say, well, Rome wasn't built in a day. But the truth of it is, I was trying to fix everything, and I can't fix it without Christ Jesus. And when you begin to do those things, your life will begin to get out of control when you're trying to be the one in charge. And so self-control allows us to live a life that will allow our life to be in order in the way that he would have us to be and be able to address those things, because why? Now is the time to address them. And with your self-control, patience. Everybody told me when I was young, don't pray for patience. But the word of God said that it's important to have patience, because why? When you are trusting God by faith, things don't happen in God's, in our timing, it happens in God's timing. God is not microwave giving or giver. Pray. On my microwave, I can push 30 seconds. I can do 1 minute, two, up to six. Then I can do up to 6 minutes and then hit the 30 second and just add to it. But I don't have to give it any more than that. In fact, sometimes I stop it, I open it up, and I check it to see, because why, it might be just right now. I don't have to go the distance. But God is not like that. He's going to answer things in his own time, and I don't care how big or hurry I am in, it's not going to happen until he's ready. And he says, you need to be patient and wait on me. And why would I be patient and wait on God? Because I found that in that area of waiting on him, it was good for me. And then when I added and trusted him in another area of my life and I waited on him, I found out that was good for me. And when he's telling us to have the knowledge of him and the goodness of him, to be able to trust him, he said, be impatient, wait on me, because why? Every time you waited on me, it has been good for you. That's what patience is about. He is saying, will you trust me in the journey? Will you trust me in the things that you're facing with right now? Because why? You're wanting something to happen quickly. Nothing changed in our lives until you begin to add faith to it. And then when you began to do that, it didn't just happen. I believe. I received Christ as my personal Savior, but everything that was broken didn't get fixed immediately.
Yep.
And it didn't take 12 years for things to get fixed. It took me willing to apply the principles of God to my life that things began to change. And then it said to have faith, wait upon Him, trust Him in His goodness, have the knowledge of Him, study your word. You'll have self-control, patience, and your patience adds to service for God. See, we've been trying to serve God without putting things in order, to wait on Him and understand. Because serving God means serving people. And when you're serving people, what happens sometimes, you understand, I was where you're at, and you can get where you need to be, and you can get there right now, like you got there right now. See, we're expecting things to happen. And we're telling people what they need to do, but we haven't given them the steps, and that is what Peter was doing. He was giving them the steps that we can live an overcoming life in Christ Jesus. See, many times when we're talking about the things that God is calling us to, we're saying, boy, you're called for this ministry, and I can see that in you and those things there, and I see a calling upon your life, but if you don't study, then show yourself approved. A workman that is able to rightly divide the word of God in truth. You'll never succeed in the call in your life. You'll never do that. You'll have to go through the steps. You'll have to go through all of those things. But if you do it, you'll be strong and you'll be able to overcome. You'll be powerful in the things of the Lord. Why is this so important? Because I got grandchildren and now great-grandchildren that right now, if nothing changes, they will not walk with God. How do I know that? Because the only Christ that they're going to see right now is coming from grandma and grandpa. And it's talking about how you're going to live it before them, why you do the things that you do, because this is God's way and it works. And when they begin to see your life being successful in the things of the Lord, how to love, how to care, how to build up, they will know then what it takes to make a marriage work or friendship to work, or how to build and get to things that you're desiring in life, and how to be a friend and how to be a neighbor. See, sometimes it looks like you're just going and being busy all the time and you're talking with all of the people and those things there, but when I'm doing those things, I'm watching lives change and people are changing. And most of the things that I'm telling them about is the Word of God, and the things I'm sharing with them is what God is able to do when you apply these principles to your life. I'm not telling them, you just need to do this, and you'll do this, and it'll be all right. Just trust God, and anyhow, no, I'm telling them nothing changes in your life until you start to do these things here. And that's where the church has gotten lost. We tell people about the end product, but we don't tell them how to get there. How do you get to go west? Go north. Go south. Well, I understand all of that. South, north, east, west. But if you don't give me better directions than that, I probably won't get to where I'm going. Some of you may not know chapter and verse. You may not know the book. But you can say to them, if you take 5 steps this way, get to the red house, take a right, you can get there. Then you go down 3 blocks there, and then you take a left at the blue house. You'll get there. See, I'm not telling you that you got to know all the scriptures and all of those things there, but you need to know how to get there in Christ Jesus. People, your neighbors are waiting to hear you say to them, this is how you get there. Coming to church did not change our life because we were sitting in church and we were a mess. But it was after somebody began to say, if you do this, you can get there. And that's what Peter was saying to the church. People are coming in and they're telling you, it don't take all of that. And here he's reminding the church, it takes all of that and more to get where God is calling you to be. It takes your willingness to surrender and allow Him to be God in every circumstance, situation in your life. How do you get there? The redeemed have God-given blessings. But we'll never receive those blessings of God until we begin to say, these are the steps of God to get me there. These are the things that it takes to get me where I need to be. If I don't do these things there, I will never be able to stand. You're going through some hardships of life, and when you're going through those things there, if you don't know that God is God, you will be overwhelmed by the stuff you're dealing with. I didn't say that you understand everything God's doing, but you trust Him because you found Him to be faithful in every area and call in your life. We've been called to serve. We've been called to serve God, but we've been called to serve a God in whom we know. That's how you serve Him. You can't serve Him and please Him if you don't know Him, going back to marriage. The struggle in the marriage was because I didn't know what she wanted. I knew what I wanted to give her, but the things I was offering, I thought were pretty good. She didn't want any of those things. Oh, some of them were all right. She would pick at them. You know, it's like a child that's, you give them something they don't really want to eat, and you say to them, you got to eat that before you eat your dessert, and they ain't enjoying it. And when you're not looking, the dog gets the rest of it. But when I began to hear what she wanted, things began to change. I began to hear. When we begin to hear what God wants of us, our lives begin to change. When we begin to hear what He's asking of us, our lives begin to change. Before, we were trying to eat it because why? Well, if I do this, it will be good for me. But we were eating it like those children where we were eating and said, Lord, this really ain't me. But then when we saw that He was what He wanted, we said, Lord, I'm going to eat it because why? Everything I eat that You offer, it is good for me. And some of you have done what I have done. Things I thought were just nasty, I wouldn't eat as a child. I love those things today. I love them. I just thought, no, it's not a French fry. I don't want it. It's not ice cream. It's not cake. I don't want it. But now I'm eating things that Mom wanted me to eat, and I love it. And so it is with the things of God. When I began to partake of the things that God is calling me to today, I understand that it's good, and I love it because what? Transformation comes. And that's what He's saying. When you begin to experience transformation in your life, you will begin to stand in the things of God. The call of God has been given to us. The challenges of the world are there. But He says, don't be deceived. Don't be deceived by the way that the world is going, and don't be deceived by some of the ways that the churches are going today. We need to know what the Word of God says. And then we begin to apply those principles of God to our lives because why? It works. Some of you have been operators on a job, and you know how the machinery works or what it takes to fix something. And you've been trying to train somebody who will not listen. Have you ever had that person? Maybe you've been a parent trying to show one of your kids how to cook something, fix something, and they're not paying one iota to what you're saying. And then they come back to you. You're trying to teach that daughter how to make that pie, and she comes back to you 20 years later and says, Mom, how did you do that? So, well, I do it the same way I was doing it when I was trying to teach it to you. But maybe now's the time that we can get it. That we can get it. Maybe now is the time that we begin to say, I didn't want to pressure my kids. I didn't want to speak to my children about, you know, what you just need is you just need Jesus. You need the Lord in your life. That's what you need. You need Christ in your life. Your life is a mess, not because of that. You're blaming all of them. Your life is a mess because you don't have Christ in your life. And you say, well, you just taught Jesus in your life. You can just trust God. You just want to talk about the Bible all the time. No, I want to talk about Christ all the time. Because Christ is the answer to our lives. When we begin to get that and down into our knower, And we understand we have everything we need to offer the people we love, people that we're coming in contact with. We're able to say to them something more than just, you need to go to church. What you're able to say to them is that, you want your life different? This is how it's going to be. If you'll do this, it'll change. If you'll do this, it will change. If you do this, it'll change. If you do this, it'll change. If you do this, it will change. And how do you know? Because I did all of those things, and my life changed. And that's what Peter was saying to the church. I know him. I was with him in the beginning, but you have the same Holy Spirit that we had. And you're able to see the same result of trusting and putting faith in Christ as we did. And you can have a victorious, blessed life in Christ. He's called the Redeemer. To put their hope and their trust in him. Amen. As we stand and sing, if you've never received Christ as your personal Savior, I'm looking around, and if you never have, we invite you to come. If you need prayer this morning, we invite you to come. If you want to become a member of this church, we invite you to come. As I said, if you need prayer, we'll pray with you. But this morning, there's truth in the redeemed. I'm just going to ask that you would stay, sing the song. Try something different today. Look at the words, sing the song. Because why? We're the redeemed. Christ did all of this that we might begin to know him. Let's do it.
My.
because you have these blessings, do your best to add these things to your life. To your faith, add goodness. And to your goodness, add knowledge. And to your knowledge, add self-control. And to self-control, add patience. And to your patience, add service for God. And to your service for God, add kindness for your brother and your sisters in Christ. And to this kindness, add love. And if all these things are in you, and you are growing, they will help you be useful and productive in your knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. Isn't that the desire of our heart? That we would be useful and productive in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We'll know how to love, we'll know how to care. We'll know how to even be still and know that He is God able to meet us. We have been called and been given a God-given blessing from the Lord for victorious living. We can be that man, that woman that God is calling us to be. So we'll come up short. But today we're going to say, Lord, I'm all in. I'm all in. I'm going to be there. I'm going to trust you. I'm going to put the building blocks together. Lord, Lego me in to you. Help me to be all you call me to be. He will mold us, He will shape us. And we will be such a witness that others will come to the saving knowledge of Christ. And so, Father, we come and we thank you, Lord, for this day that you have made. Yes, Lord, we are the redeemed. But with that comes responsibilities. We are the redeemed. With that comes change. We are redeemed. With that comes service in the knowledge of the goodness of who you are. So Lord, I ask that you would help us now, Lord, that we would be sure of this great salvation that we have in you, that we would understand the election of our call, that you have called us, Lord, for a kingdom work that will last through eternity. That's your blessing, Lord, upon these men and women. That's your blessing upon their families, their sons and daughters, upon their children and their children's children, and their children's children's children. And if you should carry farther, Lord, and longer, we ask, Lord, that you would find us faithful, doing the work that you've called us to. And so, Lord, we'll go from here. We'll not be hearers only, Lord. You have allowed us to look into the mirror of your word, and I pray, Lord, that I will not be a forgetful hearer, but may I become a doer of your word. So go with us, be with us, guide us and direct us. And we will give you all the praise, give you all the glory in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 Let's give the Lord praise. Amen. Amen. Shake somebody's hand, tell them you're glad they're here today.
Sing it again.
I'll just try to sing it.